Dante, so there's a lifetime of memories here for him, and he hasn't forgotten that his time here.
They should have put a stage somewhere on the ice and just had him start playing some country music.
Oh, yeah,
that's a big part of his life.
When he was touring before he got back into coaching, you know, he had the guitar out.
Mm-hmm.
His family, very musical. When I traveled in Legends Hockey with him, we had a lot of fun. Of course, Brian brings that guitar out and does a little song here and there. But he loves the game, and that's why he's so excited to be back in it, albeit with Buffalo.
Well, the Islanders have been making great music all year, and right off the opening draw, before they even drop the puck, Cal Clutterbuck and Zach Sill of Pittsburgh need to be separated. That's the referee, Dan O'Rourke, telling them to make sure that they're in proper position, and the puck is dropped and we're underway. The Islanders starting their fourth line, Pittsburgh effectively starting its third. Pittsburgh with Brandon Sutter, number 16, Steve Downey, number 23, and they're joined by Zach Sill, number 38. That's up front. Simone Dupre, number 47, back on defense, tangled up there with Martin. As Downey takes the puck, tries to scoop it out, couldn't do it. Cizikas keeps it in, and Martin has a shot blocked. Rob Scuderi also on defense for Pittsburgh, and a drive to the net by Martin is denied by Fleury. And those starting lineups are brought to you by Infinity Luxury Cars that deliver inspired performance.
Well, these fans are into the game already, an appreciative round of applause. National Hockey League's best fourth line goes to work early in the game. Matt Martin driving towards the net. He's knocked in by Sill towards the goaltender, so it's not Matt Martin. Fleury give Martin a little bit of a dirty look, but Martin did his best to avoid Fleury, but it's a real good start. This is going to be a very intense match.
All right, now here are the matchups on the ice now as the Islanders' fourth line settles back in. The Islanders have Franz Nielsen, even though he's not going to take the draw here. Strom, the right-handed shot, will on that side against Sidney Crosby. You figure it's going to be Nielsen against Crosby most of the night?
I think a lot of that's to do with Nielsen. Nobody's better in his own zone when you talk about a two-way hockey player than Franz Nielsen. Jack Capuano will at least start off with that, but he doesn't match lines all that often. Howie, he's pretty confident in all the guys.
DeHaan and Hamonic, the defense. Anders Lee, the third forward on the Nielsen line. And Crosby playing up front for Pittsburgh, but Lee gets a backhander wide. And then it's moved to the far side. Kunitz, number 14, on left wing for Pittsburgh, is joined up front along with Crosby by David Perron, number 39, former Edmonton Oiler.
He had a big year last year for Edmonton, scoring 28 goals, his personal high, Howie. So this is a nice acquisition for the Pittsburgh team. They were looking for someone to play with Crosby, who had some skill and could score a goal.
Tavares is line on for the Islanders. John tucks it deep into the Pittsburgh zone. Bailey in pursuit. Put it behind the net. Christian Ehrhoff, number 10. Got it as far as Malkin, but it stays in for Letty. Save made by Fleury, as Letty was able to skip one through some traffic. Here's Malkin carrying the mail into the Islanders' zone. Evgeny Malkin, number 71, with a bag full of moves away from Letty and too far for Dupre.
Outside of Fleury, Malkin's been the best player for these Pittsburgh team. He's really been carrying the team for the last month. Crosby has been getting his points here and there, but he hasn't been the factor that Malkin has been.
Alok just made a save there on Zach Sill. And Fleury's got to steer the puck to the corner, but Kuhlman immediately cuts it off. Goes to work, trying to get a forecheck. Dupre stepped in front of him. Now Grabner nudges one towards Kuhlman before it's sent all the way down. Icing waved off. And Halak will play it behind the Islander goal. Now for Kuhlman with 2:40 gone here in the opening period. Islanders have taken two of the first three meetings between these teams, one via shootout. They'll do that every time Crosby has the puck in all likelihood. Ehrhoff throws one down low. Halak made the save with a traffic jam in front.
Ehrhoff has a terrific shot. Big slap shot, but a smart move there just to wrist it.
Crosby with a backhander slipping out from behind. Halak stopped that.
Halak was driven into the back of his net. Going to have to fight for his space there, as the Pittsburgh team is certainly going to try and crowd him as often as they can.
Icing call. They'll bring it back into the Islander zone with 3:12 gone here in the first period.
Yaroslav Halak has really been off to a great start in his first half of the season. When I talked about it in the scene set, how he 14 straight wins against his division. So he's been solid. It's been important. And one of the reasons why the Islanders have been able to get a top of their division is because he's been so good in Nets form.
1 point better than the Penguins. So clearly this game is for first place. Pittsburgh, having played one fewer game under new coach Mike Johnston, 58 points, the Islanders 59. And from the draw, it's Grabner ahead for Kuhlman.
Because Mike Johnston talked about this morning about his club having to reassert themselves against the Islanders after losing that home and home sort of series, if you will. He felt his team would come out with a different purpose and want to establish himself as the superior team again.
A Tang with a backhander upstairs that's held by Halak. That series was relatively late November, the 21st, the 22nd, at home and home. And so it's been just about 2 months since these teams have seen each other.
And the Islanders really dominated them. They were very good in Pittsburgh, but they kind of blew out the Pittsburgh Penguins back here on the Coliseum. Totally dominated the game, outshot them 2-1. Pittsburgh was never in the game. As a matter of fact, the coach said that he didn't think his team played very well, and he credited the Islanders for playing really well.
Here's Rob Scuderi, number four for Pittsburgh, chased by Cizikas. Worked up the boards, but not out. Marcel Gotch, number 57, clears to center. And Letty steers it right back in. Martin in deep now. Bumped by Dupre. Cizikas in to help. Scuderi working Cizikas over a bit.
Talk about getting hitting hard. Lost his glove, Matt Martin. He got hit so hard, it just popped right off his hand.
Cizikas emerged with a puck. Dupre checked by first Clutterbuck, and then even more forcefully by Martin. And the puck scooped along by Sutter.
Well, if you count this year, Howie, the last 7 years, it's either Clutterbuck or Matt Martin has led this league in hits. So when those two guys are out there, you better expect the worst.
4.5 gone here in the first period. Each team with 3 shots as DeHaan throws it in. Lee strips to Prey. Nielsen in the corner. Now to Strome. Nice feed in front. Pushed wide by Nielsen. Great play by Strome. DeHaan dumps it to the corner. Lee against to Prey. Strome intercepts. Sets up Nielsen. Down low Lee. Took a whack at it. Fleury stopped that. Some shift for Strome.
Boy, a couple of real good opportunities. All three of those guys. Franz Nielsen, I'm sure, would like that one back. Looked like he had an empty net. Fleury wasn't expecting that pass on the short side.
Strome and Nielsen are two guys that if you looked at their recent numbers, you'd say, boy, they're struggling. No, they're not. Even though Strome only has 1 goal in his last 16 games, and Nielsen 1 in his last 11. But if you watch these guys, shift after shift, game after game, their contributions have been vital and plentiful.
Now they create opportunities whenever they're out there, and you're right, both Brock Nielsen and Ryan Strome would love to get on the score sheet on a personal level, but you just witnessed what they do very well.
Michael Grabner double-teamed. Letang out to the blue line, gets it again. He can fire it. He shoots, a save made in front. Grabner with a little nudge of a pass to Nielsen, allowing him to connect with Kuhlman. And Kuhlman banks one towards himself. Good play by Kuhlman. Islanders finishing a change, which Kuhlman allowed for by controlling that puck for a spell in that corner.
Kuhlman got that puck in deep, and Coach Capuano was talking about that, making it a 200-foot game. Not a short track, as he likes to say.
Bailey checked by Nick Spaulding, number 13. Came over from the Nashville Predators, along with Patrick Hornquist, who's injured. It was in the deal for James Neal.
And their power play, the Pittsburgh team has struggled pretty much of late, and Hornquist would be one of the reasons. He's such a factor in front of that net and around the net with the skill he brings along with his game.
And yeah, both Penguins special teams for the year have been very good despite their recent struggles, which are somewhat understandable with all those injuries and illnesses on the power play. 13-12 remaining in the first period. Bo Bennett, number 19. Moving ahead, dropped it back, Spaulding to Malkin, couldn't get around Bailey. And there's another good defensive play by Josh Bailey. And I think the Islanders are going to get a power play here. Boy, Josh Bailey had a real strong defensive game at the Garden. Makes another good play here, and Islander power play is coming up.
Islanders-Penguins game just underway, but the Islanders had a couple of real good opportunities. Good forecheck mishandled by Fleury. Ryan Strome at the bottom of your screen. Look at the pass on the backhand out to Franz Nielsen. Great opportunity. And then Franz Nielsen would give Anders Lee an opportunity. A missed poke check, but a good flipper by Fleury. Watch the little quick little hook. Not much there, Howie. They're going to call it close. Islanders are on a power play.
And that power play is brought to you by New York Lottery. Hey, you never know. Islanders have cooled off now on the power play, and it really has gone in streaks so far this year. They're 0 for their last 14 as Boychuk drives one wide.
Well, they did work on it yesterday in practice, Doug Wade.
Boychuk again. Blocked, rebound, pushed wide by Tavares.
Barking at his troops, so let's see if there's anything happening. Gotchas broke his stick.
Boychuk works on him, fires, and that one's tipped wide.
Well, I think that one right off of Brock Nelson. His stick was broke on that shot, but we didn't get enough of it, I guess.
Remember, the Islanders got off to a great start this year on the power play, struggled for a while. Recently, they'd been 7 for 20. Now they're in the 0 for 14. A lot of coaches will tell you that's just how power plays go. Nielsen brings it in. Nielsen to the backhand, in front for Oposo. It didn't reach him. Good play. Defensively there by Paul Martin, number 7.
Real nice entry for the Islanders.
Boychuk or Nelson. Out of Tavares. Minute to the power play. And now it's a race as Sill and Boychuk tussle. And Boychuk engages Halak.
Well, you got 6 men on the ice. Use them all. And Donnie Boychuk, smart veteran play, chipping it back to Halak.
I don't know if that happened often when you played, but would that be a situation where maybe Halak was calling for him to do that?
He might very well have. I mean, yeah, it's a situation that, you know, even in our day, we used that play if we thought we were getting beat to the puck.
Now the Islanders go to work in the corner. The second power play unit's on. Letty to Hamonic. They're playing catch. Hamonic, Letty. Hard feed down low to Strome. Good feed. Hamonic, wrist shot, loose in front off a save by Fleury and cleared all the way down by Sutter.
Now, Anders Lee not very happy. He was given the referee a little lip service. This particular power play was very good yesterday in practice. Scored 2 or 3 goals, moved around very smartly.
Penalty about to end. Hamonic offside just. Well, let's see. The penalty clock says 1 second remaining. Sparling comes out of the box. And we may be dealing with fractions of seconds, and they're going to wash that last little bit out so the power play is over.
Well, watch Lee in front of the net, up and around the hash mark, so he's moving himself into different positions. Lee moves in and out, always trying to get in the way. Good screen on the goaltender, no interference. Fleury did a nice job of getting up tight to Lee. That's what the goaltender should do on those screen shots. Get up as close as possible, take away as much as the net. Don't let that forward back you into the net. You've got to be strong and fight for your space. Fleury did a nice job there.
You see the Penguins now 20 straight on the PK. Islanders 0 for 15. They had one shot on that power play. We've got 10:49 remaining in the first period. And stay tuned, because after the period, Butchie and I will chat with Brian Trotche up here in the booth.
See if we can get him to talk about some old stories.
I don't think we'll exactly, need to tug at his arm to do that. But and he's a great storyteller, too, so make sure to stay tuned. Not only for that, but tomorrow night, too. We'll be back on MSG Plus in Montreal, where, let's see, if you hold up 2 fingers, that's the total number of Fahrenheit degrees that will represent the high in Montreal tomorrow. But indoors, our live coverage begins at 6:30 with Visa Islanders game night. Islanders and Canadians tomorrow night on MSG Plus.
As we look at Sidney Crosby, just watch this shot from the point.
Fleury juggled the shot by Hamonic.
But Crosby and Malkin have 16 of the last 18 goals, Howie. Either one of those guys has been involved in it. So that shows you how important they are to that particular hockey club. Not a lot of offense gets done without Malkin or Crosby being involved. So if you can keep them off the score sheet, then you got a pretty good chance to win the game.
Well, good luck with that. But that's how they're able to stay near the top of the division with all the injuries.
Yeah, when you have a 1-2 punch and they play together every once in a while, 4-on-4s, Crosby's not all that happy. Well,
you could write the tweets yourself, can't you?
Oh, yeah.
With fans on Sydney and what some people have felt is excessive whining. Am I being politically correct? Some people have felt
A lot of people at different times think Sidney gets a little bit on the whiny side.
He's a great player, though, and there's no getting around that.
It never detracts away from his ability and his compete level and his skill level. But, hey, listen, sometimes you got to sell something. And if you squeak long enough, you know, what do they say, the greasy wheel, whatever that expression is.
Well, he had the mumps earlier this year. That cost him a few games.
Well, there's the active leader. Well, look at 1-2, Crosby Malkin. So a little wonder why they seem to be able to get a whole lot done with a lot of success.
We can't go into Pittsburgh without you and Sidney spending some real quality time together in the morning.
He's such a gentleman, and he loves to talk hockey, and I don't have to talk about that particular game that's going to happen that night. I can talk about all kinds of different affairs, you know, as like this morning talking about the All-Star game and asked him his opinion. He said, I'm old-fashioned, but I'd like to have them play East-West. He said, I love the rivalry. I love to play against the West. He said, but you know what? The captains choosing teams, it's pretty interesting to see the strategy that goes on as to what kind of team each team wants to get together. So those are the things for me that are fun to talk to Crosby about.
I think the strategy is going to look a lot better than those jerseys.
Yikes.
Yeah.
Here comes Grabner. Grabner pulling up on Erhoff. Now to Kuhlman, but he's stripped before he ever really had possession by Malkin. 9:46 to go, first period, no score. Grabner's going to go. He just spun Harrington around. Yeah. Delayed penalty as Fleury heads to the bench.
Going to be tripping her knee, and Harrington, fortunate for him, he didn't get hurt on that play. That was a dangerous play.
So we get the whistle, and Michael Grabner will take a seat as the Penguins will go to their first power play. 9:32 to go, scoreless first period. Tonight's GEICO hometown hero is Air Force Staff Sergeant Caitlin Tufel. I know, we know that last name spelled that way is Tuffle, but she pronounces it Tufel. She's from East Meadow, right here on Long Island, right near the Coliseum. Caitlin was a traffic management craftsperson processing cargo and munitions in support of operations Enduring Freedom and Iraqi Freedom, and we all appreciate the work of Caitlin Tufel. Right now, the Islanders defending against the Pittsburgh power play as Kamenik slams one around the boards. It stays in, but then is given up by Perron, and to center comes Nielsen, shorthanded. Remember, the Islanders with 7 shorthanded goals, tied for most in the league. Back in is Malkin, across to Kunitz, he shoots, they score! Halak looked like he stopped the first one, and then it's batted in. You know, Crosby was driving to the net. It might have been Crosby, but it's a power play goal, and the Penguins have a 1-0 lead.
Yeah. Kunitz gets a pretty good shot away, and Halak makes the first save, but as Crosby's driving towards the net, but the Islanders on an offensive opportunity, Ryan Strome has to make sure he gets it deep, because that's an odd man rush for the Pittsburgh team. Good pass all the way across to Kunitz. Crosby going to the net right off the side of his body. And it's 1-0 Pittsburgh. You can see Halak has the puck. Crosby just drives towards the net. And an unlucky bounce, really, for Halak. Not sure if that pass was supposed to go from Malkin all the way to Kunitz, because Crosby was in between. So the Pittsburgh team, on a lucky goal, strikes first. They'd only scored 9 goals in their last 29 games, Howie. In fact, Sidney Crosby had only 2 power play goals in his last 36 games.
And, you know, there's a little delay here. I think they're waiting at the scores table for word from Toronto. They can just go ahead, because there might have been some thought that maybe Crosby had kind of angled his shoulder and directed that puck. But once they drop the puck, there can be no further review. It's ruled a goal. And Pittsburgh has a 1-0 lead as Crosby gets his 13th from Kunitz and Malkin at 10:52.
Yeah, can you believe 2 power play goals in his last 36 games, Sidney Crosby?
No.
That's hard to believe, and his buddy Malkin only 1 in his last 21 games. So Pittsburgh power play has not been very good, but it's struck early.
Well, Pittsburgh scores first. The Islanders are the last team in the league that would be intimidated by giving up the first goal of the game. They've been more than resilient under those circumstances this year.
They're the best in the National Hockey League with giving up 1 goal and still winning hockey games, provided they get the next goal.
Well, they're 13-4 when they have allowed the first goal of the game, and 12-0 when, after allowing the first, they score next. So that's pretty heady stuff, or in this case, shouldery stuff. And then there are those numbers. which are kind of hard to ignore too, because Pittsburgh generally a prolific team, and when they score first, there's a pretty good chance they're going to score second too.
Like most teams in the National Hockey League, that first goal seems to really give them, you know, what they need, get them on their toes.
Cizikas to Hickey, that's blocked away in front by Letang. The penalty coming, and he is going to be to the Islanders here.
A high stick, not sure who's getting that. Looks like Clutterbuck.
Pittsburgh's going to go right back to the power play.
Yeah, that's just a tough start for the Islanders, who really had
15,
some real good opportunities. Clutterbuck in front of the net. Let's take a look. A few couple of cross checks, nothing big there. And there's the over the top, and that's a good call on Letang, no doubt about it. You can't go over the top of someone's shoulders with your stick. Clutterbuck, always an aggressive and antagonizer, but that's not a good penalty. And Pittsburgh goes right back on the power play.
At 11:51, 59 seconds after they scored the goal, which put them in front. So the Islanders back to the penalty kill. Perron, number 39, twists it around to the near side where Crosby waits. Crosby to Malkin. Malkin closing in. Kunitz had been knocked down. The pass to Kunitz. Crosby jams at it. Halak covers, and there's no further play.
Crosby had about six whack at it. Halak was extended. Puck was in tight to Halak, so Crosby couldn't get it up. He just kept whacking away and trying to chip it up over those pads. Travis Hamonic was eventually able to get in. But Malkin with the quick little pass to Kunitz, deflection, and watch Crosby. He whacks it three or four times. And Halak's got that left pad down on the ice and refuses to yield, trying to look for that loose puck. The Islanders will try to put pressure on this Pittsburgh team, not allow them that kind of time, Howie, to make those cute little plays.
And three shots credited in that little exchange. Drive from the blue line, they score! A one-timer that was taken by Perron, and it's a power play goal. Two power play goals in a minute and 30 seconds have given Pittsburgh a 2-0 lead.
Perron, as we talked about, is acquired because he has a terrific shot and he can score goals. And that's a long-range one-timer. I'm not sure if Halak sees it or not. Again, Islanders had an opportunity to get it out. They didn't clear it. And then the Penguins go to work. Letang right to the middle of the ice. And there sets it up for the one-timer. And Halak trying to get a look at whether or not he sees it. No, there's no chance. Hickey, pair of 14s are in front, screening Halak. No chance for him. And the power play is really put the Islanders in a hole.
But there's a giveaway. Tavares stop, loose puck. Hickey throws it towards the net, comes back to Tavares, and Fleury makes a save. Now Oposo in the corner, trying to wheel out, comes together with Erhoff. Oposo knocked down, and the fans, incensed after the two penalties called to the Islanders, wanted one there to the Penguins that doesn't come.
You have to wonder whether Jack Capuano thought about calling timeout after those two quick goals, Howie, just to settle his team down, but the Islanders have responded with a couple of good opportunities.
And go offside. And a lot of times, I know some people say, should it really matter if there's a TV timeout coming? In this case, there's not. There won't be a television timeout now, I don't think, until we get under the five-minute mark. And so with 6:58, or six-minute mark, pardon me. So with 6:58 remaining in the period, you know, there's still a little time before that TV timeout, so this would be a strategic area to use it if Jack felt that way.
Yeah, you wonder, you know, you have a good pulse on your hockey team, whether or not they're rattled or not. You throw that from behind the net, from behind the bench, excuse me.
Got caught on top of the net, bounces back down. Hamonic drives one. It's blocked in front. And Downey for Pittsburgh with a head man to Gotch. Licked away by Hamonic at the last moment. Dupre. And all he could do just to wait for Sutter to get back onside. Hahn plays it around towards Hamonic.
It's not like the Islanders haven't had some opportunities. They've had two or three real good scoring opportunities. And it's not like Pittsburgh is outplaying them and dominating.
But here's Perron making a move to the slot. Nothing there. And Lee rolls it.
It'll be a good test for the Islanders now, Howie, to see how they respond. It's been a long time since they've been down a couple of goals.
Perron got it at the back of his skate, slides it in, blocked from the trapezoid. Martin takes the hit from Perron as he works it up to Clutterbuck. He and Erhoff wrestle. Letty pounces on the loose puck. Letty in for a shot that was blocked by Harrington. Harrington, the rookie defenseman, wearing number six. And Crosby. That's back into his own zone. Attakunas. Eliminated by Letty. Pittsburgh changing. 5.5 to go here in the opening period.
Harrington's only played 6 games, Howie, and he's a guy that's just a steady defense and nothing spectacular.
And he's going to get a power play here. I think it's Harrington who's going to go for slowing down Nelson with a hold or a hook. And the Islanders will go to the power play. 5:20 remaining, first period.
Welcome back to Nassau Coliseum here in the first period. The Islanders trailing by 2 goals to the Pittsburgh Penguins, looking to make something happen here before the end of the first period. Coming up on the Forwarded Admission Report, though, Ryan Trotsche is in the house. He's being honored as one of the several alumni that are making their way through here at the Coliseum over the last year here, and he will be chatting with Butch and Howie in the first intermission. You know they have lots to talk about. You're not going to want to miss it. It's all coming up in the Forwarded Admission Report. Guys.
Yes, thanks, Shannon. I guess it's kind of fitting that we're going to a power play now that the Islanders are anyway, because thanks to Brian Trotsche, Butchie didn't get as much power play time with the Islanders as he would have liked, but they can fight that out between periods. This Islanders power play is brought to you by New York Lottery. Hey, you never know. Harrington for a hook at 14:40. Islanders' second power play. They had one shot on their first. Boychuk throws it in. First to get it. Flips the referee with a wind around. Comes to Nielsen, though. And Tavares all the way to the other side. Boychuk, pass to Okposo, turning against Gauch. Okposo to Boychuk, wrists one, knocked away by Nelson, who wrestled into the corner by Letang. Puck retrieved by Nielsen, but slapped away by Gauch.
Always tough in that slot area. Every team collapses to try and take away those shots from that high percentage area. It's a dangerous pass. Franz Nielsen, nice job to get the puck back, but tough pass in that slot area.
And the Islanders change the power play unit. They've got Strome, Lee, Bailey, Letty, and Hamonic, the point man. Here's Hamonic waiting on the board. Now to Letty. Strome to Letty. Hamonic, wrist shot tipped wide as Lee made the deflection. Letty to Hamonic. Moves up. Put it off the leg of Spaulding, recovered now by Strome. Pushes back for Hamonic. Rashut again went off of Spaulding. Strome, nice read, jumped on it. To Hamonic. And then Letty to Hamonic. Lines it up, feeds Strome, fires, and the save by Fleury.
Well, good job of puck movement by the Islanders, able to set up both Hamonic, Letty, and then Ryan Strome. So a lot of shots headed towards the net. But Fleury has been very, very sharp. Of course, the defenders falling in front allows that shot to happen there. There's a good deflection by Lee. That's a long-range shot. Ryan Strome, a tough angle. Fleury has perfect angle on that save.
Here's DeHaan. Let's go a drive off the boards. Batted by the glove of Scuderi to the corner. 6 seconds remain on Harrington's penalty. And the Penguins clear, and the Islanders will take another offer on the power play. They had 2 shots on that one.
Well, you have to like the puck movement, Howie. Certainly give the Pittsburgh team.
Nice move by Tavares. Throws it across. They score! Okposo from Tavares. And the Islanders cut the Penguins' lead to 2-1.
Terrific individual effort by John Tavares as he challenges the Pittsburgh defense on a one-on-one scenario. Kyle Okposo going to the net. I think it goes in off his skate. They'll certainly review this one, and no doubt about that. Toronto will take a little look at it, but I didn't see any kicking motion. Tavares on Dupre. Look at this. Outside, inside, and then the quick pass across. I don't think that's going to be called back. I didn't see any kind of kicking motion at all. I just see him glancing, driving towards the net. All his weight on the right foot, Howie. It's tough to kick the puck if you got your weight on the right foot.
Look as though he was attempting to shoot. You saw him sort of jab at the puck with his stick almost as far as to a follow-through. And then the puck looked like it deflected in without a distinct motion. I think that just goes in off of the blade.
Yeah, when you're skating, Howie, and you got all your weight on that outside foot like Kyle does, you can't kick. You need to get your weight on the left foot to be able to shake the right foot loose. So it's pretty tough to kick that thing in with all the weight down there. So I would be surprised. My buddy Mike Murphy's back there, and he knows. He's kicked a few in himself. He knows the difference.
Yeah, think of the extra assists you got thanks to his feet.
Yeah, we didn't have this kind of video, and we lost a few and gained a few, no doubt about it. But I seriously, I don't see that as a kicking motion at all, simply because he had a stick in position, he was waiting to try and tap it in, and he had all his weight on the right foot.
And here's the announcement.
After further review, the call on the ice stand, good goal.
Well, some fans went into a yes, 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 and now others will, as Kyle Appulso has his 10th goal of the year. Nice setup by Tavares, and it's 2-1 Pittsburgh.
Yeah, Dupre, welcome to the National Hockey League when you play against the elite hockey players. Tremendous inside or outside-inside move by John Tavares. A much-needed goal.
And there's the yes, 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 and all of its high decibel glory. Martin to the net, chips one over the crossbars. Fleury came out. Hamonic drives one. That's blocked by Crosby, and Halak is going to play it away. At least that was the plan, away from Crosby. Instead, Crosby cut it off, but the puck ricochets out of play.
And what a play that was with Matt Martin. I believe it was DeHaan who flipped it up on his backhand. It was like an alley-oop type of play. Matt Martin trying to run underneath it. Just about got there in time. A very aggressive move by Fleury prevented that. You can see there's the poke check. Matt Martin does his best to avoid Fleury. But what a great play. Great ingenuity, great imagination with DeHaan and Matt Martin.
So, from the draw, Penguins control. Malkin fires and missed the net, and boy, did he ever lean into that.
Good faceoff play by the Pittsburgh team. Malkin, after the faceoff, jumped into the slot.
Good hit by Bennett on Nelson, and the Penguins dump it back in. Malkin flicks it into the corner. Letty wound it around. Malkin got a piece of it. Tavares and Bailey got the assists on Oposo's 10th at 16:51. Kyle now points in four of his last five games. 2:07 remaining in the opening period. Remember, Butchie and I will chat with Brian Trottier in our forward intermission report. Oposo angled to the boards by Gotch. And then Oposo and Letang turn each other around. By the way, that assist was number 200 in the career of John Tavares. I hope you got a chance to see the beginnings show on JT, which debuted after the game of the Garden the other night. Now it's Hickey. Put it down low. That's busted by Gotch. And Hickey is being chased by Sill.
Good energy by Kyle Appulso. Really working hard in the corners for the Islanders. A good time to change for them. Goal rejuvenated the fans.
Hickey in the corner. Takes a good hit from Sill. Worked around by DeHaan. Strome didn't clear the first time. And now DeHaan hurls it back to the near side. Hickey bottled up by Crosby, but Nielsen helps out. Gets it to center, where he's met by Kunitz. And we're into the final minute now of this first period. Shots are 11-9 Islanders. Pittsburgh leading 2-1. Hamonic off the boards for Nielsen. Tried to get it to Strome. Didn't get enough of the pass. And then Lee twists it in behind the Pittsburgh net as the Islanders begin a change. 40 seconds to go in the period. Perron ahead for Kunitz. Tried to drop it to Crosby. That deflected away. And Dupre's got it backed up in the Pittsburgh zone. That's going to be an icing, will it not? Yep. And they'll bring it into the Pittsburgh zone. 28 seconds to go in the period. Monday night on MSG. Might know him as Leon from Curb Your Enthusiasm. We all know him now as J.B. Smoove. He'll be back to MSG with a brand new season of four courses. Join J.B. and guests Todd Barry, Jim Norton, Jerry Cooney, Gilbert Gottfried, and Neil deGrasse Tyson. It's Monday night at 9 after Knicks basketball on MSG Network, presented by Cadillac. J.B. and Gilbert Gottfried in the same room at the same time. That's got all kinds of possibilities. Now DeHaan with 12 to go in the period. Across to Hamonic, wrist shot. Hit his own man Clutterbuck. And Malkin with 5 lays it ahead to Kunitz. And he snaps his stick on a dump in that goes straight to the net as the horn sounds. So at the end of one here at the Coliseum, Pittsburgh with a couple of power play goals with a 2-1 lead over the New York Islanders. So stay tuned. The Ford intermission report is coming right up. Crosby and Perron for Pittsburgh, Oposo for the Islanders. And we will be chatting with Islanders legend Brian Trottier. We'll also have highlights a little bit later on, but stay tuned. We'll be back with Trott right after this. Now we're getting set now to begin the second period. The Islanders getting that goal from Kyle Oposo cut Pittsburgh's lead in half. So the Islanders again will start their fourth line, the Cizikas line, against Pittsburgh's third line, centered by Brandon Sutter, who of course has ties to the Islander dynasty as he is Brent Sutter's son. So Penguins work it in. Halak around to Hickey. Now Martin along the boards, checked by Dupre. Jerome Dupre taking on a more and more important role for the Penguins almost nightly, particularly in the aftermath of the injury to Olli Mato. He's out for the year.
Yeah, Mato is a very fine young player to choose up a lot of minutes. Dupre gets an opportunity and gets to play with Scuderi, who is almost like a mentor to him, trying to teach him to play a very consistent game.
A lot of room for Hamonic off the turnover from Sutter. A drop from Morton. Put it out in front. An aggressive poke check by Fleury. Got to the puck before Clutterbuck could. And in comes Crosby. But the play offside. With 56 seconds gone in the second period. Our trivia question tonight is brought to you by Cadillac. And why not make it about Brian Trottier? 500 for the Islanders. 24 for the Penguins. There's only one other player in the National Hockey League who finished his career with exactly 500 goals. You think about it. It was a name that Islander fans wanted so badly to forget at one point, by way of a hint.
By way of a hint.
Yep. That's all I'm saying.
Felt like from a playoff series, possibly.
Well, now see, I don't want to give him any more, but
okay.
You can attach that to it if you like.
Penguins just had a 4-on-3 and went offside, Howie, and something you never want to do.
Nielsen hits the post! Nielsen from the slot with a great chance.
Franz has that tricky wrist shot of his. He kind of just almost cradles it and then lets it go. It's a quick snapshot. It gets there a lot quicker. Surprises goaltenders. Watch him load it up. Drops that right shoulder and then zips it over the left shoulder of Fleury. You can just see the hesitation as Ehrhoff has got pretty good position. But Franz puts it in the shooting lane, if you will. And a nice move with the right shoulder just to set it up.
So the Islanders control the draw. Bailey against Letang in the corner. Now to Oposo. Threw it to the slot and bounced before reaching Tavares, allowing Letang to get a piece of it. And Spaulding sends Malkin on his way. Cross now to Bo Bennett, number 19. His pass through the slot. Letang, the defenseman, in deep. Now to Spaulding. He sent it off of Tavares' skate. Recovered by Letang, and he steered it wide.
Nice job of back-checking by Malkin. So strong on the stick. Caught Hickey, or DeHaan, excuse me, standing still just for an instant.
And Bailey winds it in. Hurry around to Letang. That's stopped by Oposo. Shove from behind by Letang.
Yeah, that was a cross-check. Letang got away with one. The near referee didn't see it. He was screened out, but the far referee certainly had a good look at it.
And as Oposo went to the bench, you could tell he was stunned by the hit. Whether he was hurt even for a brief moment or not, we don't know, but he certainly was surprised, A, to get that hit from behind, and B, apparently that nothing was called.
You can get a little bit of a whiplash from those type of hits, the cross check and through the middle of the back.
Bray around right off the top of the dashes. And into a pack along the boards with nobody controlling. So Dupre does. Stayed in. And Dupre now has a chance to move it out. Right up to Sill. Working against Brian Scrape. Cizikas around. Only Penguins there as they were changing. It's Perron. Round to the near side. Clutterbuck cuts it off. Hustles to center. and flicks it into Pittsburgh territory. Butterbuck keeps going. He and Ehrhoff turn each other around. It came in front, missed by Martin of the Islanders. Hickey to the fallen Clutterbuck. Finds Cizikas, squeezed to the boards by Christian Ehrhoff, number 10. And that little scrum. And a penalty coming here. Now Cizikas was in a wrestling match with Ehrhoff. We'll see who's going here.
Not sure if it's going to be two and two. Casey Cizikas using his strength, his lower body strength, to just kind of bowl over the Pittsburgh Penguins. Looks like they're both going, which is a pretty good call. They were both doing battle in the corner. You can see Cizikas and Ehrhoff. Ehrhoff has the arm around him. That was holding.
Islanders number 53, 2 minutes roughing.
Well, a good call on both ends. Casey gave him a little elbow in the chop area, as I like to say. And Ehrhoff was doing his holding bit. Now Islanders will play 4-on-4. This is the cross check we're talking about behind from Letang.
It's
comes
a two-hander
in.
Right there.
Yeah, he gave him a pretty good hit, and you can see it had an effect on Kyle Postal.
So 4-on-4. DeHaan busts a play at the Islander line. And it forces it offside. 3:43, the time of those penalties.
Yeah, and that should go all the way back down as Martin knew was a delayed offside and still played it. Good defensive play by DeHaan as he's able to knock that pass from. Attempted pass from Sutter over to Martin. The Islanders have to be careful on these faceoffs. The defense will jump in up on the play and create odd man rushes if you're getting a little lazy on your tracking, if you will.
And from the draw, Tavares working in the corner. Martin and Letang, pair of Penguins, came together, but Pittsburgh emerges anyway. Bennett softly towards Sutter, didn't get there. And DeHaan. Worked over by Bennett. And now Tavares moves out. Tavares up to the Pittsburgh line. Swings it over to Strom. A drop for Hamonic. Back to DeHaan. Hamonic. Wristed one. Stop. Tavares keeps the heat on Letang.
Fleury's been very good. A little more calm and quiet than I've seen him in the past. Playing with an awful lot of confidence.
Something he lacked in that playoff series 2 years ago against the Islanders.
And that's still the test for him in his playoffs.
Oposo, a shot. It changed direction going off of Scuderi on the way. Oposo for Nielsen. 52 to the 4-on-4. Oposo forced back to the corner. Sets up Letty. Across to Boychuk. Big drive. And the save made. A blocker save by Fleury. And that puck goes out of play.
Yeah, he's able to follow it all the way. Make a nice save. Sends it up into the net area for a faceoff. Boychuk has a lot of time. Takes a good hard look. But look at the aggressive positioning by Fleury. Just steps to his side. Follows it all the way like a bat catcher. Following that ball into his glove. Boychuk went down to Fleury and whispered something into his ear. Perhaps trying to get into his kitchen just a little bit.
Well, Gotch and Bailey draw with 40 seconds remaining to the 4-on-4. A touch more than 5 minutes having been played here in the second period.
This is a little different period than the first one. A lot more offensive opportunities in that first period. This has settled into more of a defensive battle now. Both teams a little more responsible.
Grabner up to Bailey and over the line to Boychuk, jumping down the boards. Perron picks it off. David Perron up the left wing and over the Islander line to the slot. He shoots, save, Halak, big rebound, pushed to the corner. And doesn't matter whether it's a one-timer, a slap shot, or a wrist shot, David Perron can shoot it.
Yeah, he has a great shot and good instincts. It was a 3-on-2, so he delayed enough to be able to cut into the middle and change his angle. Good save by Halak.
Malkin, nice moves. But Cizikas out of the box, picked it off. Islanders don't get out, though. So Hickey, under pressure, finds Cizikas. Gets a second chance. Hooks up with Strait. And Brian Strait goes up the left wing, but that play is offside with 6:09 remaining. 6:09 gone, I should say, in the second period. Tonight's Cold Hard Facts are brought to you by Frost Brewed Coors Light. Yaroslav Halak becoming the fourth Islander goaltender to go to the All-Star game. When Billy Smith went, he wound up winning the MVP.
No surprise, nobody go near the net.
Howie, you think he still has the car?
Long range shots there on Billy Smith. Chico, of course, a great goaltender for the Islanders in the earlier years. And that was a little different format, too, in those days, was it not, Howie? He didn't automatically get a player from every team?
Yeah,
you know.
It's ironic in some ways that the All-Star game, and more so perhaps now than ever, the game, the All-Star game itself, is probably the farthest thing imaginable, as a drive by Martin goes wide, farthest thing imaginable from a regular NHL game.
Yeah, really isn't. There isn't a whole lot of checking in an All-Star game. Just a lot of skill out there and a lot of odd man rushes.
Letang with some skill. Halak the save. Comes through the slot. Martin tees it up. Off a stick. Letang plays it across. And now Spaulding. Goaltenders ought to get double the money for being in an All-Star game. Letang in the corner. Put out in front for Malkin. Takes another whack at it. Spaulding a shot. And it's smothered by Halak.
Hey, you watch that sequence of play and you wonder how that puck didn't end up in the net. Well, because of that man there with his secondary effort, just refusing to yield. What a big save. And then he, again, kicks that right pad out, gets that blocker side on Spaulding, who looks like he's got a sure goal. Puck bounce for Malkin, and there's the first save, and then Halak stays with it. Strong down low, makes a huge save, and that's what he's been doing all year. You look at his goals against average, 2.10, that's fabulous, but he's been consistent. He's made big saves at key times for his team at this season.
So from the draw, Hamonic pushes it ahead, cut off. Here's Crosby with a drop for Perron. It's busted in front. And on comes Calvin DeHaan. Try to go to Kuhlman on right wing. That was blocked. And Crosby by himself for now. Trailed by Perron. Crosby checked by Hamonic. Nelson goes to the corner with Perron. Kunitz in there as well, but he's checked by DeHaan. However, Perron emerges with a puck for Pittsburgh. Slip back for Crosby. Hamonic got it back though. Nikolai Kuhlman lugs it ahead through Perron, or so it seemed. Kuhlman to Grabner, but he didn't hold it. Nice play by Kuhlman.
It was a good second effort by Kuhlman. It had Pittsburgh Penguins draped all over him, and only the strong legs that he possesses allowed him to continue on.
Herhoff had it go off a stanchion, and Halak had to be a Gumby-type goaltender to keep that out.
You don't see too many bad bounces at that end of the rink, but Halak will put that in his memory bank.
There's Nielsen over to the corner. That's the fun house in this building, the Zamboni entrance. Now to Lee, straight at the line, throws one to the net, off the glove of Fleury. Letang goes the other way, but Hickey is first to get it. Now to Nielsen, well covered by Sutter. Strome with a drive block. Now it's a race. Downey's got a step. Downey's in. He backhands Halak aggressively with a save. Big save by Halak. Here's Downey again, and he turned the jets on, did Steve Downey.
Yeah, I didn't realize he was as good a skater as he displayed that area there. Ryan Strome did the smart thing. He just sort of stayed with him and didn't give him a free rein. Harassed him just enough, but didn't take a penalty.
Now in on the left wing. Comes Adams, checked by Cizikas, as was Mark Arcabello, number 26, just picked up from the Edmonton Oilers. Scuderi, loved down in center by Boychuk, played by Sill, carries in, goes to his backhand, Halak, with a kick save, left a rebound, but now the Islanders to center, it's Martin, and over the line, Martin continues to carry, got it to the net! And a save made by Fleury as Clutterbuck went into Fleury. First Fleury hit Clutterbuck, then Sill did. So Clutterbuck was sandwiched in between a pair of aggravated Penguins. And now Oposo looking for Tavares. It's behind him, and Malkin turns on the Jets. Evgeny Malkin, good back check by Oposo. Malkin uses his strength, shot it wide. And then Martin for the Penguins. Works it down the boards. Bennett out of the corner. He's double-teamed. Tavares, blind pass, gave it away to Spaulding. And now Hamonic. Crisply on to Bailey, and now Tavares against Paul Martin. Played by Martin Letang on the puck.
Tavares needed a half a step more to be able to create an angle, a step in front of Martin. They were equal, if you will, in the race. John Tavares couldn't get that extra step he needed.
Nervous coaches, this game's opening up a bit. Bailey brings it in. Bailey to the slot. Shoots one. Fleury the save. Rebound straight. And that floats into the corner for Tavares. Now to Hickey. Thomas Hickey trying to dance towards the slot. Couldn't get there. He tried to beat a couple of Penguins. Now he's scrambling to get back. But Pittsburgh needs a change. And so the Islanders are okay. And straight moving down the right side against Harrington. Pulls up. Down low, Kulamäki looked to put it in front for Nelson, but again, Fleury was aggressive, and Kunitz carries in against Grabner.
Talk about transition. As soon as the puck turns over, the opposition goes in the opposite direction in a real hurry. Islanders are driving towards the net. They've been in Fleury's crease a number of times.
Nelson to the slot, shoots one wide. Grabner upended, and the puck caught in behind there. Grabner working against Crosby. And then Grabner and Erhoff turn each other around. 8:17 to go, second period. 2-1 Pittsburgh. The Penguin goals coming on the power play. That was in the first period, as was the Islander goal by Okposo.
Well, these last 4 or 5 minutes have been very quick as both teams up and down the ice. Like to see the Islanders throw the puck at the net a little bit more. Not try to be as gifted.
Now Downey. Or Brandon Sutter, the Islander fans in full force being heard. 17-15, Islanders in shots. Lee tried to chip it out, he did. Now to Strome, bursting down the left side. Strome drops it towards Nielsen, but that was deflected away by Sutter. Comes to Lee, fires, that's blocked. Then Strome turns, shoots, he scores! Ryan Strome has tied it, it's 2-2.
Well, you knew somebody was going to score sooner or later, Howie, because the game had opened up. There was chances at both ends of the rink, and it's Fleury that kind of gives in first. Ryan Strome has one shot. It's blocked. He stays with it, picks up his own rebound, and is able to get it past Fleury, who gets caught in his crease simply because of the first shot. You can see Fleury, he's stretched out, but look how far inside his crease. And Ryan Strome is able to work his way in front of the net with good hard effort, secondary effort if you will. But it's been that kind of a second period, trading opportunities, and Ryan Strome is all smiles now. And you mentioned earlier on how he hadn't scored in a while. Well, as now.
It's his first goal of calendar year 2015. He last scored on New Year's Eve in Winnipeg. That was 6 games ago, but that's the only goal that he had scored in 16 games. Coming into this one, but for Strome, number 8 on the year, and the Islanders now tied 2-2. Although the Islanders have just iced the puck, but there again, the Islanders, resilient as they've been all season, climb out of a 2-0 hole and get the game locked up.
Well, I like what they're doing, driving towards the net. They've stopped in front of the net several times. I mentioned they bumped into Fleury on a number of occasions, Nelson and certainly Clutterbuck. And they got the puck towards the net, Howie, and we talked about just simplifying the game. Get the puck towards the net. Don't worry so much about the fancy play or the gifted play. And that's what happened there as Ryan Strome picked up his own rebound, just shooting the puck.
Lee and Nielsen picked up the assists. That's a 3-game point streak now for Anders Lee.
Of course, Anders Lee has 5 game winners as a rookie.
And now Bennett back in, shooting one. A glove save made by Halak, and there'll be a face-off in the Islanders' zone. 6:58 to go, second period. 2-2 game here, latter stages of the second period. Introducing MSG Go, the only app that lets you watch MSG Network's coverage of live Knicks games anywhere. Download now at the App Store or Google Play. MSG Go is currently available to Optimum subscribers. So the face-off in the Islanders' zone. Islanders now with Nelson, Kulamäki, Grabner up front. DeHaan and Hamonic the defense. Crosby's line out for Pittsburgh. Crosby by himself here into the Islanders zone. Kuhlman put the body on him. Hamonic laid some lumber on him. And now it's Erhoff for Crosby. Sidney trying to keep it moving forward, first with his reach, then with his legs. And he might be deceptively strong, too. His muscles went to the front of the net.
Yeah, he's very strong in the on the lower half. And, you know, he gets himself in those positions where he forces defensemen to lay the paws on him, and that's where he gets a lot of those, what you would think would be called cheap hooking and holding calls. But when you got a guy that's as strong as he is and puts himself in such good position to take those penalties, he earns them. And you're right, Howie. I mean, he is so strong down low.
Tell you what, I know it's only mid-January, but there's an almost tangible springtime sort of tension in this building now. Of course, these teams played in the playoffs 2 years ago, and this joint was as loud, frankly, as I've ever heard it. And you could only imagine what it's going to sound like this spring.
Yeah, and talking to Travis Hamonic about the Pittsburgh team and the Ranger game, and he was saying that there's a different rivalry here with Pittsburgh. He said, I don't like these guys. I don't really know the Ranger guys. I don't like these guys, and a lot of the team feels the same way. This is a team that you don't like, you hate. So you get that good rivalry, and that's because of a playoff series.
5:27 to go, second period. Sill checked along the boards by Boychuk, who then is sent down by Sill. And then Tavares tried a spin move on Sill, who would have none of it. Tavares trying to protect the puck as well as himself.
And Sill has a good reputation as a youngster. He's voted the hardest hitter, the best defensive forward, and the hardest worker. So pretty much seeing what he does.
Now Tavares, a little short on that pass to Okposo, and the Penguins in transition. Downey to Gotch, plays it across center, shoots, and that clipped the post. And Halak and the fans can exhale for now.
A long shift for the Tavares line. Get caught a little bit tired. He can't back check. Pittsburgh turned that turnover into a good 3-on-2 opportunity. Sutter's been a very, very good player for the Pittsburgh team. Very consistent, solid in both ends of the rink.
It's a gift icing for the Islanders. Letang was barely a stride away from the red line there.
He's wondering what the heck that was all about.
They're going to bring it all the way down for the icing.
And the Islanders will take it, slow the pace down.
This spring, Broadway's biggest spectacular will be at Radio City Music Hall. The New York Spring Spectacular, starring the Rockettes, March 12th through May 3rd. Visit Rockettes.com/spring. And they're going to say that Letang got to the red line. The officials are admitting the mistake and dropping the puck at center ice.
And as you pointed out, Howie, it's a good decision, because you're right. That was so close. Usually would give someone the benefit of the doubt. So let's have a center ice faceoff.
Penguins keep it. Spalling in front. Little scramble, but the puck comes to a lock. And there's no further play, so we'll step out. 4:22 remaining, second period on the island. Welcome back. Here is our Islanders upcoming schedule, brought to you by Lexus. Get it easier, at least not tomorrow night. Montreal will be the site. Islanders and Canadiens. Flyers will be in here for the Martin Luther King game on Monday, and then a week off.
That's the easy game right there. The All-Star weekend.
Yeah.
Well, there's the Islander goal scorers, Kyle Okposo and Ryan Strome. And as you mentioned, he'll be a guest with Shannon in between periods.
Shots right now on the board are 18-17 Islanders, but the attempts are 45-29 Islanders. 16 blocked shots by the Penguins.
And there's that faceoff play again that the Pittsburgh team used in the first period.
It's math. I'm sorry, Coach. It's math. I'm, you know.
Well, that's Eric's job. You can't be expected to do everything.
I'm so bad at math, he had it right, and I read it wrong. How did I ever get out of high school? I sat next to somebody smart. Malkin now. This is balling.
Well, the Islanders made a quick change on defense. They have Letty and Boychuk out there now against Malkin. So I've been watching you talk about the strategy, and Mike Johnson trying to get Malkin out against Hickey. Hickey a good player, but a smaller player, so trying to take advantage of Malkin's size.
3:39 to go here in the second period. Martin. I couldn't stay on site. He was dangling that puck at the line, and they couldn't hold it.
Yeah, a little bit too fancy at the blue line, though. You're down the last 3 minutes of the period. You've come back. You've tied the game up. Pittsburgh thrives on turnovers. Matt Martin knows that. Fourth line, their job is to get it in deep, go to work down low, and they've been very good. You want to stay in that focus. Don't get carried away with your offensive skills.
So Crosby out for the Pittsburghs. And the Islanders with their fourth line, which will get a piece of Sydney at every opportunity. Perron hit by Martin. Not only Crosby, the Islanders are looking to hit. Well, Scuderi was trying to sell the icing there, but he just couldn't slow down enough to keep up with a slowing puck.
Yeah, you're
late in the period.
You're pumping your legs, but you're not moving.
Neither's the puck with some ice chips with 3 minutes left in the second. Scuderi lines up a shot, twirls it in behind. Hamonic stops it there. Tavares digging against Crosby. Martin took a pretty good hit from Kunitz.
Still won the battle, though. Matty Martin so strong along the boards.
Here's Perron shooting, and a save by Halak. Able to control it long enough for the whistle, and then Crosby and Martin get further acquainted as if they really needed to.
They're good friends off the ice as we watch Clutterbuck and Perron get into it. Perron, boy, he is has such a good shot. Gahan and Kunitz. So the game's heating up a little nastiness going on. With the two teams. Watch the quick release by Perron. He's not scared to shoot. That's what you have to have playing with Crosby, because he's going to get you the puck a whole lot, so don't hesitate to shoot the puck. You have a guy like Kunitz that's going to go to the net, so that to me looks like it could be a very good line, very solid line. And of course, once they get their healthy bodies back, Pittsburgh, particularly with Hornquist, it'll give them a little bit more depth.
So we're down to 2:44 remaining in the period. And of course, Clutterbuck wasn't going to go to the bench without getting some kind of last word in there. Made sure Perron heard whatever it was he was offering, and Cal's not done yet.
He's an antagonistic kind of guy, no doubt about it. Loves to get under your skin, loves to play physical, loves to drive towards the net. Any edge he can gather from, you know, getting in your kitchen a little bit, Howie, or tugging at you, he's going to do it. Going to make life miserable for you.
It's a form of intimidation, I suppose, but it's just agitation more than anything else, isn't it?
Well, it's called being a pest.
Here's Erhoff firing. Every time I hear the word agitate, think about Muhammad Ali. Always used to use that, and hopefully the champ is doing better today as he's been hospitalized.
Just celebrated a birthday the other day, did he not?
Yeah, 73, I believe. Brock Nelson down low. Grabner put it just beyond the reach of Kuhlman. Harrington knocked down. He's behind the play as the Penguins move up.
Yeah, Michael needs to shoot that. He was in tight to the net. Throw the shot towards the net. Let Kuhlman handle the rebound if it doesn't go into the net.
2:07 left of the period. Kuhlman just wants to send it deep and then head off on a change. And the Islanders send the Tavares line out. The Pittsburgh, Bo Bennett. Not allowed to get into the Islanders zone. Boychuk had him. So Oposo with a nice move away from Spaulding in over the line. Kick save, rebound Tavares. Didn't get there. Erhoff with an effective check.
Yeah, great shot there by Kyle Oposo. Kept it down low, and the rebound was right there for Tavares.
Tavares to Oposo. Missed the net. He's back to Tavares now. Returns to Oposo. Out of Tavares using some strength himself. Back at the line. Gages Boychuk. Johnny Boychuk absorbed the shove from Spaulding. Moved it towards Bailey. He's knocked off balance by Harrington. And it squirts to the stick of Brandon Sutter for Pittsburgh. Now it's banked off the boards. Bennett prevented from gaining control by Oposo. Bailey up to the line. Final minute of the period. Penguins get it back. Bennett has a pass knocked away by Bailey when the Islanders change it.
Good decision there. Josh Bailey the first time turned it over. Won't need to do that. Keep it ahead of you.
And into the last minute of the period, the Islanders miss an opportunity to set something up from the blue line. And they've got to go back into their own zone. Ryan Strom. Cross ice. Nielsen puts it behind the net. Two Penguins on Anders Lee. Generally, it takes two to keep Big Lee from establishing any sort of presence near the net. Crosby to Malkin. A perennial headache. Perron drive. And that's off the end boards. Caroms to Letang. Chris Letang to Perron. Perron knocked down by Hamonic. There'll be a penalty. Letang in front. Martin across. They score. Pittsburgh takes the lead on a goal by Crosby with 4.4 seconds remaining in the second period. It's 3-2 Penguins.
Big push by the Penguins. Able to control the puck. The Islanders got running around a little bit. It's first time they've really been yanked out of position. What a tremendous play. You can see there's the penalty, and then the Penguins go to work, and Paul Martin, he's got Crosby all alone, wide open. But the Islanders out of position and not able to help a lot. That's a tough goal to give up late in that period.
So Crosby with his second of the night, and the Islanders gonna need this upcoming 15 minutes or so to get the taste of that goal out of their mouths, as it was scored at 19:55 and change. 4.4 seconds remained when Crosby, with a delayed penalty in effect, as the Islanders were going to take a penalty, but Crosby's 14th from Martin Letang. And so it's 3-2 Pittsburgh, and coming up our Chevrolet intermission report. Shannon will chat with Ryan Strome, who had tied the game for the Islanders. Mike Bossy joins Shannon in the studio. We'll have second period highlights.
Well, it's always difficult, Howie, to give up a goal late in that period, particularly with the Islanders having such a strong second period.
But at the end of two, Pittsburgh 3, the Islanders 2, the Chevrolet intermission report is next. And here's our game recap brought to you by Tri Honda Dealers. That Crosby goal was the one that puts Pittsburgh in front as we get set to start the third period. Before we do that, though, we'll revisit our Cadillac trivia question. Brian Trottier, an even 500 goals for the Islanders, 24 more for the Penguins. The only NHL player who finished his career with exactly 500 goals. Not necessarily an Islander villain, because he's a great guy, but he scored a goal that eliminated the Islanders in the 1978 Stanley Cup playoffs. More famously, as far as the entire hockey world is concerned, he raised that cup for Calgary. That was in Montreal when the Flames beat the Canadiens to win the Stanley Cup in what was the final game of Lanny McDonald's career.
Fitting into a very, very good career by Lanny McDonald. You're right, he's a terrific guy. Does a lot of charity work back in Calgary now that he's retired.
Came into the NHL as part of a great draft in 1973, the year Dennis Bundchen was taken first overall. So the third period underway. Islanders again starting their fourth line against the Penguins' third line, the Sutter unit. Sutter up for Sill. Straight, preventing Sill from getting any room. And now Hickey and Nielsen managed to help chip the puck into the Pittsburgh zone. And the teams already begin a change. Not quite a minute into the period. Fleury had to be ready for that shot from the blue line by Dahan. And now Letang lofts one that appears destined to go for an icing on that fresh sheet of ice in the first minute of the third period. And it does.
Now both teams always trying to press the issue with breakaway passes, little chips here and there into the open space, trying to gain a step or a little advantage on the opposition, whether it's the Penguins or the Islanders. Coach Capuano makes a quick change with an offensive faceoff, sends out Tavares' line against Crosby.
So the draw controlled by the Penguins. Chris Letang, number 58. He was emerged into an outstanding defenseman in the National Hockey League.
He's not very big when you talk about height-wise, but he's so very strong on his skates, possesses a tremendous shot.
And here is Letang, not given room to launch that big shot. Hamonic, good hit on Crosby. Perron feeds the blue line to Martin. Tried to return it to Perron. Looks like they just got their signals crossed. Crosby and Hamonic bump. And a wobbly puck shot back in offside by Martin with a minute 38 gone here in the third.
Quick whistle by the referee. As could see that Perron was already down on the ice and it was going to be an offside, so no reason to get involved in a delay.
When you see those numbers on Crosby, 3 more points tonight, 2 points a game roughly against the Islanders for his career.
You know, we've been singing the same song for about 5 years, Howie, about every time you play Pittsburgh, you know, how do you stop them? And it always comes back to number 87 or number 71. And tonight, both the guys are having a good game, but statistically, Crosby's having a real big night.
We talked about his strength earlier. If you take that and just put it on a shelf for now, what's the one other element of his game that you think might go most overlooked? Anything about him that people might really have to watch carefully to understand about him that makes him so special?
Well, I always talk about people's hockey sense, and it's such a gift. Not everybody has that ability to recognize the play so quickly, and you don't always talk about it because you see guys with so much skill, Howie, you know, the quick hands, the quick back passes, and the ability to score goals, but a lot of those things don't happen unless you've got that hockey sense.
More than 2 minutes gone here in the third. Still 3-2 Pittsburgh. Letty played it down the boards. Ehrhoff snapped it back the other way. No icing here. Halak's got to play it, and he does to his defense. It's Letty. Nick Letty sweeps one towards the right side. It deflected on the way. He was looking for Bailey. Dupre got in tight with a referee as well as a Poso, but the Penguins emerge with a puck. And it's sent in by Craig Adams, number 27. Straight cut it off. Poso bothered along the boards by Arcabello, who recovers the puck. Throws one to the net, but Halak steers aside. Arcabello out of Yale University.
Scored a lot of points in Yale, too, and he's there for 4 years. 49 goals, Howie, and 116 points. So he has some ability, but hasn't been able to establish himself. He's only about 5'8", so... Sometimes it takes the little guys a little longer to get themselves an opportunity.
Cabella to Letang, couldn't control it. Halak out of position, gets back now as Martin lets go. A drive that's gloved by Halak, and he'll hold.
Gotch was all alone in front of the net. A nifty move, as you mentioned, by Letang to be able to clear the outside. Gotch wasn't able to handle that puck in front of the net. As you mentioned, Halak's out of position, number 57. He has an empty net to tap it in. And a nice easy save off the Paul Martin shot. Halak again getting himself back out to the crease, reestablishing himself. But Letang, we talk about him jumping up on the play all the time. Very good skater. Great instincts and lots of offensive skill.
From the draw, that is Hamonic round to Clutterbuck. And now Cizikas. And over the line looking for Martin. He couldn't reach it, and Martin got tangled up with Scuderi. They both went for a spill.
Almost an interference there on Scuderi as he cut off Martin.
Perron in the corner looks for Crosby. Absorbs the hit from DeHaan. Tried to one-hand it. Instead, Perron helps out, wins it. Backhands a save made by Halak.
Everybody after Crosby and forgetting about the other two guys on the line, which are pretty good players in their own right.
Pittsburgh missing some key guys up front. Hornquist and Dupuis, but when picking up David Perron just off of his game tonight, he is really going to help them.
He really is, because he's a goal scorer. I mean, they talked about it before, even, you know, one of the reasons they had Como come in, and certainly with Hornquist adds a little bit more offense, but they talked about as soon as Dupuis went down, that Crosby was going to need someone to play on the right side, and they were going to be looking for that replacement. And I think they've got themselves the right guy, because certainly a gifted athlete with a tremendous shot, nice skills, tough in the corners, good worker.
These are two very good road teams, but you saw the Penguins' numbers. Bennett put it out in front. Malkin powered one to the net, just using strength to get there. Halak stopped it.
Pittsburgh with a little bit of a push.
Ehrhoff a drive, slapped away in front. You had Spaulding trying to deflect it, and Hamonic may have been the one who batted it away. Now Strome to the far side, just chops at it, doesn't clear. Harrington kept it in. Strome again throws it out. It lands in the Pittsburgh zone. Now Harrington back to play it. Now for Spaulding. This pass was slowed down by Nielsen, recovered by Bennett. And he wrists one that caroms out of play. 4:53 into the third period. Now tomorrow night on MSG Plus, you can join Al Troutwig and E.J. Raddick, Steve Valiquette, and Mike Bossy working back-to-back games. He can handle that. They'll break down the local hockey scene and go around the NHL. Hockey Night Live tomorrow night on 9:30 on MSG Plus.
And then speaking of Mike Bossy, we were listening to Brian Trotsky earlier on talking about Mike Bossy, the playmaker. Well, I don't know what he was thinking there. Mike Bossy had... He was a goal scorer. He wasn't a playmaker. If he got assists, it was on rebounds. Sorry, boss.
I'm only laughing as Letang tries to get it to the net because, Mike, you should have seen Butchie's expression when Trottier said that. Here's Lee with Strome. Lee a shot. Fleury juggles. Lee again. Rolled wide. And Sill unable to clear it past Lee. Boychuk fired it wide. Letty, Nielsen's one-timer, hit a stick. Strome tried to play it back to Boychuk, but that was cut off by Downey. Sutter pitches one towards himself. Looked like he might have gotten a stick up on Letty there, and that's what the crowd reacted to.
And it looked like there could have been a two-minute penalty there. You're right, as Letty took out Sutter, he came up with a stick pretty high.
Perron with a shot from basically the corner. A hard wrist shot, and that really tested Halak. Icing called against the Islanders here. Boy, if Halak had been the slightest bit off of that post, Perron's got a goal.
Yeah, they might have been teammates back in St. Louis a few years ago, with Perron originally a St. Louis draft pick. Oh, there's the Boychuk talking to Perron. There's a good play by Anders Lee, and he stops too. He makes a good shot, and then puts himself in position as Fleury's not able to handle that rebound, takes it to the back end. Lee quietly just goes about and does his job.
Just about 6 minutes gone of the third. Kuhlman lost it on a Scuderi stick check. And then with a second effort, steers it back in. Dupre in trouble. Now Crosby with a little room towards the slot. Drops it to Kunitz to the backhand. He got it on goal. And that was stopped by Halak. And all three of the guys on that Pittsburgh line, Crosby, Kunitz, Perron, well, they can really test a goaltender from virtually any place in the offensive zone, sharp angles, or anywhere else.
Well, they come up the ice with such speed that they're able to back the defense off, Howie. And then once you play a little time and space with their talent.
Also a drive, and that hit a stick on the way.
They make things happen.
Bailey throws one to the net through a screen. Oposo scores! Oposo was able to lift it over Marc-Andre Fleury, and the Islanders have tied it 3-3 with 13:18 to go in the third period.
Well, something very noticeable is Fleury over the last couple of minutes has not handled the puck very well, and he's given a couple of rebounds, and that's a rebound goal as Bailey's able to get the puck towards a nice play by Hickey, drop it back, quick wrist shot, and there's the rebound again, and that's why Fleury was so upset with himself, is that he's not able to handle that rebound. Kyle Oposo drives towards the net, and there's your short side goal. Blame Fleury on that one. He's got to do a much better job of controlling his rebound. But again, a harmless shot towards the net. And we talk about it all the time. It's never a bad play to throw the puck in the net. It makes things happen.
Well, it's Oposo's first two-goal game this season. His 11th this year. So a two-goal game for Crosby, a two-goal game for Oposo. It is 3-3, 13:10 to go in the third period as the resilient Islanders come back again.
And it's been pretty much a Pittsburgh period, really. They've dominated play, if you will, more time in the offensive zone than the Islanders had spent early on. So big goal for the Islanders, could change the momentum, Howie.
So wish these teams could play about eight times a year.
Absolutely. I mean, stay in your own division, you get all kinds of rivalries, and the fans are into it, the players are into it.
Now Letty races in, offside of the Islanders with 12:38 remaining in the third period. Really a typical Islanders-Penguins game, and it's tied. There is the pair, the Marians, who have done the heavy lifting in our game recap brought to you by Tri Honda Dealers. Two each, Crosby and Oposo. Tavares and Bailey assisted on Oposo's 11th at 642. Oposo has never had a hat trick, but he's in position. Boy, would the Islanders love to get another one from him here in this tie game. Kept in at the line by Letty.
And you do go a little harder when you have two goals, yeah. No doubt about that. You think about it, especially if you've never had one.
And all you guys used to say in the locker rooms after the games was, oh, I wasn't thinking of a third goal. No, just, you know, one shift at a time. Nielsen, a backhander save. Rebound chipped at by Letty. Boychuk fires one wide. See, it all comes out now.
It does. And Ryan Strome in front of the net with Christian Ehrhoff. They were whacking and a hacking, and they were getting into it.
Thanks, Clyde. Nielsen to Strome, and he throws it in.
What a terrific pass that all started with Franz Nielsen getting the puck to the outside.
Ricky brings it back in, left it at the line. Sill chips it the other way. Downey slowed a bit by Bailey, and that allows Oposo to come back and retrieve the puck. So straight knocks it off the boards. Martin or Sutter, although Martin just tried to jam it out off the boards. It hit an Islander, and eventually it was Sutter.
Well, the good news, too, Howie, is when you do have two goals, you're going to have a tendency to shoot. And a lot of times you look for that pass. You get two, you shoot more often than not.
Well, now the face-off off the icing will be in the Islanders' zone. That show beginnings on John Tavares was terrific. It wasn't as though it was an interview. It's not like, you know, John was asked questions and then answered all on camera. Questions were posed to him, and he just went with his answers, and it was very well edited. Really good show. Hope you get a chance to see it again. Beginnings on John Tavares.
It's always great when you can get the guys in a relaxed setting where they don't feel like they're, you know, they're in an interview situation.
First star of the show actually might have been John's mom. Mom always does win those awards.
Yes.
She spent a lot of that show talking about John's childhood. 10:49 to go in the third. There's Perron again. Across to Kunitz. Sharp angle, given nothing by DeHaan. Out of the slot, and it's driven wide by Perron.
Again, the Islanders losing track. This is one line that's been very, very good for tonight for the Pittsburgh team, obviously with Crosby with 3 points, but they've had plenty of opportunities. The Islanders, a little more communication in the defensive zone when these three guys. Make sure you pick up your men. Make sure you know where they are.
27-23 Islanders in shots. Remember, the Islanders with a one-point lead in the division over Pittsburgh. Penguins have played one fewer game. Just a shade past the halfway point of this season. Islanders at the moment 1 point behind Tampa Bay for the conference lead. Malkin, a shot, hits a leg. However, the Islanders coming into play tonight had played three fewer games than the Lightning. And this will be one of those three in hand.
This has been a very competitive game. Last time that these two teams met, the Islanders dominated, but this has been equally played. Good opportunities at both ends of the rink. Good pace, physical at times.
9:35 to go in the third period. Letty away from Bo Bennett. Letty angled towards the boards by Malkin. Islanders work it deep. Teams changing on the move. And now Sutter. Brandon Sutter played it across. It hit Strome. And is recovered in the Pittsburgh zone by Letang. And the fans really becoming active now. Sutter trying to get to the net. Couldn't do it. Strome chips one towards Nielsen. Franz wrestled by Brandon Sutter, who lost his stick. Up comes Strome. Strome pulls up, feeds Lee, backhands wide. Lee again. Lee fires one through the crease. Comes back to the blue line to DeHaan. Wrist shot into the glove of Fleury. 8:43 remaining third period. It's been another Islander Penguins doozy, and it's even.
tied at the Nassau Coliseum, 3-3 with the Penguins. Hockey's a game of one-on-one battles. Franz Nielsen, Brandon Sutter. Watch the leverage that Franz Nielsen uses. A little chip pass support by Ryan Strome. Now, watch this particular play. You talk about patience, time. Watch Ligo in this area here, driving towards the net. Watch Lee's. He's going to find the hole, patience, wait, and just couldn't quite handle the pass. You talk about hockey sense. Ryan Strome has plenty.
Coming up, the Foxwoods Final Five. Foxwoods, excitement every day. Bailey to Oposo. That is embarrassing. Went wide. Oposo looked to return it. The defensive play by Martin prevented that, and up comes Crosby. Cutting in over the Islander line. Crosby pulls up, looks for some help. The trailer was Perron. He played it down low, picked off by Hamonic. Islanders in transition. One man back, a second gets there. Bailey to the slot of Oposo. He scores! It's a hat trick for Kyle Oposo! And the Islanders have taken a 4-3 lead with 8:09 to go in the third period. His first NHL hat trick.
And now the hats are on the ice. I told you he'd shoot the puck if he got the chance, Howie. We got the opportunity, but a play starts with a good defensive play down low in the defensive zone by Travis Hamonic. He makes the key interception. He has the vision, the patience to intercept the puck down low. And then Josh Bailey waiting and waiting and waiting. What a beautiful cross-ice pass. John Tavares drives towards the net. That created the opening for Kyle Oposo. Just a perfect pass. Look at Josh. He's looking. Travis Hamonic on the play. But there's Kyle Oposo. They practice that every time they have a practice. They have someone driving to the net, someone hooking back into the slot. In this case, it was Tavares to the net, Kyle in the slot, and he beats him on the stick side with a beautiful wrist shot. Well executed 3-on-2.
Boy, this place is jumping, and the ones who aren't jumping are throwing, as in hats on the ice that have just about now all been cleaned up. Oposo with his first career hat trick, and the last Islander who had a hat trick against the Penguins, Miro Chetan, back in 2006. We saw Miro here about 6 or 8 weeks ago.
Yeah, he's still in the area. Yeah, still in the area. Loves the island, but that man's loving life large right now. 3 goals in tonight's game, and a big influence on this comeback for the Islanders, who were down 2-0 early in this game.
Everybody on the Islanders' top line, meaning Oposo, Tavares, and Bailey, have 3 points. For Oposo, all goals, and 3 helpers for Tavares and Bailey.
And expect a big push now from the Pittsburgh team. They're a pretty resilient bunch of guys themselves. And the Islanders are going to have to keep up the pressure.
What an atmosphere in this building right now.
It really is. It's been, obvious. I don't know how many home games we've had, but it's been the same every doggone game, and it's just makes it so much more fun for even the players, because in spite of what they'll tell you, they can hear this.
10th sellout, 4 straight, 6 of the last 7, and there will be more where that came from.
There's going to be
many more.
A tremendous support for this rest of this entire season, and it'll be tough to get a ticket. It will be like the old days where you just it'll be supply and demand, and there won't be any supply.
And that's straight from the ticket office. I was in there chatting with some of the guys today, and their inventory is shrinking by the minute. They're shrinking here while the ticket supply is shrinking. And now, as the Islanders fans are taunting Crosby, a linesman has gone down at the far side. That was Derek Manson.
Yeah, I don't know if he tripped or he just wanted to get a better look and paint as close to the ice as he possibly could, but even while he was lying down on the job, if you will, he was able to make the correct call. Pittsburgh went offside. Both of these teams have gone offside a number of times, uncharacteristically for both of these teams. But the onus is on the guy with the puck. He's got to make the decision, chip it in or carry it in. Don't force your teammates offside.
Well, so much for Tavares' 3-point game. They've taken an assist from him and given it instead to Hamonic. So Bailey and Hamonic assist on Oposo's hat-trick goal, his 12th of the year.
Yeah, it was Travis Hamonic that made the outlet pass out to Josh Bailey.
Now, 7:28 remain in the third. You talk about a Pittsburgh push, Butch. Here comes Sutter to the net, put it in front. It was missed by Sill, who went to the net, but Sill recovers the puck. Nobody home at the blue line. Harrington wasn't there. And Fleury's got to handle it.
I used to kid Brent Sutter about his speed or lack of, but his son certainly has a lot of speed.
Now DeHaan across to Hamonic. Wrist shot deflected, save made by Fleury. I think that went off of Crosby.
Now, Fleury looked very calm, very cool in the first two periods. Not so much in this third period. A lot of rebounds he hasn't been able to control. Wasn't able to handle that shot in his trapper from Travis Hamonic. So he looks a little shaky right now. You and I talked about it earlier on, how he does not like playing the Islanders. They make him uncomfortable. If you watch that shot from Travis Hamonic, I think Karam's a little bit off of Lee, I think, in front of the net.
Penguin had touched the puck with a high stick, which is why they stopped play. And now Strom to the slot. Got it towards the net, but it was broken up before Lee could reach it. And out comes Kunitz. And over the Islander line. Went off of Hamonic. Lee trying to get towards the puck. But as he's angled away from it, he'll just head off on a change.
There'll be a lot of quick changes now for the Islanders. 30 seconds, try to chip it in and try to change.
6:27 to go in the third. Islanders trailed 2-0. They trailed 3-2. It was 3-2 going to the third. Oposo has scored twice in this third period to complete the hat trick and give New York the lead. DeHaan floats it in. Martin for Pittsburgh off the boards and out. But Malkin well covered, preventing a Pittsburgh rush. Boychuk the other way for Oposo. Yeah, Tavares open on the wing on the right side.
That was a hard pass from Boychuk on the backhand of Kyle Oposo. Always tougher with that curve to handle passes on the backhand.
Now Letang in over the Islander line. Letang takes it wide to the boards, hits the trailer air hop. Big shot went wide. The Karam towards Malkin, trying to reach it, he does. Now to Letang, and then Erhoff. Traffic in front. Letang looks that way, fires, it's deflected over the glass and out of play. Well, buckle up, it's going to be a heck of a finish. 5:28 left in the third. Islanders up a goal.
The Islanders lead the Penguins 4-3 late in the period. It starts with Travis Hamonic. He makes a good defensive play as he anticipates the pass, takes a couple of quick steps, and there's the quick pass to Josh Bailey. Bailey looking to see what his options are all about. There's Kyle Oposo. Watch John Tavares as he heads towards the net. Bailey buys some time, a nice little pass, and there's the shot, stick side. A well-executed 3-on-2. Good defense, Howie, always leads to good offense. That man there, Bailey's got 3 assists tonight, but nice play by Travis Hamonic.
Letang, a shot blocked. Josh Bailey has 3 games in the NHL with 3 assists. They've all been against the Penguins.
Loves the Penguins.
Straight around towards Kuhlman. It slowed down, but Kuhlman puts the right touch on a pass to Nelson. But a good back check by Downey got it away from him.
I've been impressed with Downey's skating ability. I did not realize that he was as good a skater. You recognize him as being an agitator, a tough guy, but he has good wheels.
Created a chance for himself by breaking ahead of the pack back in the first period. Now here's Grabner. Actually, that would have been in the second period. 4:48 remaining in the third. You're watching the Foxwoods Final Five. Foxwoods, excitement every day. Visit foxwoods.com now. A lock in his trapezoid. Kunitz recovers it in the corner. Hamonic wrestling there, muscles it up the boards. Penguins keep it alive. Hamonic chips it loose. Cizikas to Martin. He's got the red line. Now he's got the Pittsburgh blue line. The Islanders will try to get a forecheck here. But Martin couldn't regain the puck. Cizikas does as Dupre was knocked down. 4:14 to go in the third. Up comes Crosby, now to Perron. Perron lofts it into the corner. Nielsen there squeezes through Crosby's check. It's recovered though and fed back to the line to Dupre. He drives one off of DeHaan. Loose in front. DeHaan recovers. Pitched it to the boards and it's cleared out by Strome. Good recovery by DeHaan.
Yeah, and Johnny Boychuk's hurt. He's holding that stick with his very gingerly with his left hand. Looking for a change as soon as he can get off.
And he's going now, and Boychuk, who's had all kinds of sort of black and blue marks over the first part of this season. Needs a little more attention on the Islander bench.
Islanders need to be good in the neutral zone to slow the Penguins down, not allow them to carry the puck over. That's where their strength really is being able to carry the puck with speed and then establish possession.
We'll keep an eye on Boychuk, see if he can take his next shift. 3:19 to go in the third. Olak plays it. Around, Bennett waits for it. It hit Bennett. Tavares with Malkin comes in front, a backhander by Downey, is swallowed up by Halak, and there's no further play.
Tavares is wondering why there was no penalty as the puck was slapped off, the stick was slapped out of his hand, I believe, by Bennett as he went behind the net. You can see Tavares' stick's broken. Wants to know why the referee missed that call, so both... That was Malkin who put the slash into Downey, I'm not sure which one, but anyway... Malak is able to cover up down low, and his stick's broken also, so nobody's happy down there. A lot of slashing going on. Referee's probably making the right call, not calling anything either way. He's upset, and Tavares was upset.
Looking over at the Islander bench, Damian Hess, the Islander trainer, there you see him with his hands on the shoulders of Johnny Boychuk, who's missed 10 games this year. Letang has a drive block.
Well, he was hanging on to his left hand. Looks like he got it jammed a little bit as he went behind the net to handle the puck. That's when he lost the stick.
We're under 3 minutes remaining in the third. 4-3 Islanders. They've outshot the Penguins 30-24. Kuhlman keeps it deep for now in the Pittsburgh zone. That is objective A for the Islanders at this point. Letang to center behind the play. Nelson knocked down, and Downey is going to go. A penalty to Downey with 2:41 remaining in the third period. And certainly frustration was evident on Steve Downey just moments before that last flurry. And now he takes probably what you'd have to call a slashing penalty born of frustration. Mike Johnston can't like that with only 2:41 to go.
No, he will not like that. There's just a good shoulder, and there's the slash by Downey, and then the cross check just for added measure. Didn't get a 4-minute penalty, only got the two, but that really was frustration on the non-calls earlier on, and then the good shoulder check by Brock Nelson on Downey. And you're right, he will not win favor with the coach on that move.
And certainly, Jack Capuano implores his team, I'm sure, to some extent, to make the safe play. You know, the Islanders also now, with 2:41 left on the clock.
Interesting power play, Howie. Excuse me. Four forwards and one D. A lot of coaches would not have four forwards out there. They'd have two defensemen. Islanders continue to go with their normal power play.
Boychuk's that 1D after being banged up on his last shift, but he lets go and drives. Fleury the save, rebound to Tavares, save, Fleury, rebound, score!
Could be a fourth goal for Kyle Okposo as he was in front of the net along with Tavares, but that's why Jack Capuano put out four forwards, Howie, to get the shot on net. That's why he's down there and we're up here. It was a great call and a great result for the Islanders. They get a strike for a power play goal. They make Downey pay big time for his mistake. But I believe it's Kyle Okposo is going to have a four-goal game as he was in front of the net in the dirty areas, in the reward areas. There's the shot. Fleury makes the first save, can't handle the rebound. Another shot by Tavares, another one by Kyle Okposo. So if at first you don't succeed, try again. First Tavares, then Okposo. Big goal, that's four for Kyle.
So a career night for Kyle Okposo. The Islanders lead 5-3 with 2:31 remaining, and you just saw Jack Nicholson eyes fire type countenance on Steve Downey. But anyway, the last Islander with a four-goal game was Matt Molson, who did it in Dallas a little more than 3 years ago. And the Islanders a three-goal third period, up two. And we'll see about Fleury and when Mike Johnston decides to pull him. 2:15 to go in the third. And I believe we're getting a hand pass called on the Penguins here. It's going to bring the faceoff outside.
That was a high stick, actually. Heisman was waiting to see who touched it. Jack Capuano came back with the Casey Cizikas line for this particular scenario. Now he comes back out with Brock Nelson's line, Kuhlman and Grabner with the tremendous speed. Travis Hamonic, this first shift after the goal will be important, not to allow the Pittsburgh Penguins any kind of leeway.
Fleury at the hash marks. Penguins have the puck. Letang sends it in. Fleury is on his way to the Pittsburgh bench. Penguins net is empty. They have an extra skater on with just under 2 minutes remaining in the third. Grabner with another steal. Tavares and Boychuk assisted on a post. Those fourth of the game. But Tavares gets his three-point night after all. But here's Erhoff slowly out of the Pittsburgh zone. Empty net for the Penguins. Perron to the slot, surrounded. Hamonic takes him into the corner. Down to a minute 37 left. Grabner chipped ahead. Here's Kuhlman. Pulls up, throws it at the empty net and misses. Hey, could they get Kyle Okposo a five-goal game with that empty net? Perron charging towards the net. Perron a shot going upstairs on Halak. Nothing there for him. Malkin with a minute 20. Towards the slot. Missed by Letang. Grabner racing ahead to the empty net. He's got it. 6-3 Islanders. It's a four-goal third period. And this place is jumping.
And you have to love what the Islanders were able to accomplish in the defensive zone this last 30 seconds or so. Pittsburgh really didn't get much going. The Islanders jumped all over them, didn't allow them any time. And then with a good quick clear to the jet, Michael Grabner, and he fired that thing from the red line, plowing it up high into the net. He wanted to be sure he was. What a tremendous effort by the Islanders. What a tremendous response by the Islanders after giving up those two quick power play goals.
You hear the yes, yes, yes. And the Islanders on the verge of their 30th win of the year in 44 games.
And you have to wonder what Pittsburgh's thinking now. Can they beat this team? Because they thought they had a pretty good start to this particular game, but the Islanders have come roaring back.
You know, Butchie, it's fair to say if the Islanders had a little bit better goaltending in the playoffs 2 years ago, they could well have stolen that series from the Penguins. And well, here they are tonight coming back a couple of times.
There's no doubt about that, that the power play for the Pittsburgh team and the weak goaltending in that series for the Islanders definitely compromised their opportunity to win that series. Of course, Fleury was not all that great himself.
And the crowd apparently is chanting, "You can't beat us."
Well, that's kind of what I was alluding to. So a little frustration. And again, Fleury not having a very good third period. A lot of rebounds. Didn't handle the puck all that well.
And a big night for the Islanders once more here at the Coliseum. Four goals in the third. They defeat the Penguins 6-3. The Islanders increase their lead over the Penguins to 3 points atop the Metropolitan Division. They take over the Eastern Conference lead in points. One more than the Tampa Bay Lightning, one fewer than Nashville and Anaheim for the league lead at the start of play tonight, at least those Nashville and Anaheim point totals. Nashville playing tonight against Washington, Anaheim at home against the Devils. So a four-goal game for Kyle Okposo. Last four-goal game by an Islander here in this building by Steve Thomas against the Devils a little less than 23 years ago. That's the yes, yes, yes salute that the Islanders have given their fans. Boy, you gotta love how that's taken on. Huh?
Yeah, they're having fun with it. How impressive was Halak tonight against Fleury, the two all-star goalies, the two replacements. And Halak was the better goaltender, as one would have expected, certainly if you're an Islander fan. Islanders 35 shots to 24. What a third period. My goodness, they were relentless. They just took it to the Pittsburgh Hockey Club. And at the end of the day, we're the better team.
Well, if you have a chance and you don't have a ticket,